Today's topic, molecular basis of inheritance. Actually, inheritance process. Inheritance. So, taking the inheritance is nothing but as a the transfer of characters from one generation to the another generation. So, principles of inheritance we are already knows into the another chapter, that is the principle of inheritance. Genetics we are taking means. Okay. So there what it is happened, characters are transferred from one generation to another generation. Here you are taking means one generation to another generation. This is generally simply called as an inheritance. In this topic, molecular basis of inheritance. Here also inheritance is occurs. That means the characters are transferring. So it is discussing into the characters how they are transferring from one generation to the other generation, means through the genes. Already we discussed into the principles of it. So those genes, how they are transferring from the parent generation to the next generation, the new characters, how they are forming, and what are the components they are involving, all the topics we are discussing into the molecular basis of inheritance we are taking. So generally in this topic we are taking means nucleic acids structure, types, and DNA. In that too we are taking means and RNA, how these are acting or how these are participating in the inheritance process. So those things we are discussing into the this topic we are doing. So first of all, the nucleic acids are nothing but as a, here the structure of nucleic and the types we are taking DNA and the RNA. These two comes under the types of the nucleic acid here. Nuclear materials we are taking. Okay, the nucleic acids are forming by a key components. They are nothing but as a pentose sugar, nitrogen bases, and the phosphate ions. Okay. So phosphates are, so these are the components of the nucleic acids we are either in the DNA or the RNA. So either in the case of the deoxyribonucleic acid or the ribonucleic acid, these two, the difference is the oxygen is removed from the ribonucleic acid, ribo sugar we are taking means, so that it is forming into the deoxyribose and the deoxyribose. Only the one oxygen molecule difference is there into the these ribo sugar. Yeah, the pentose sugar is nothing but as a ribo sugar only. Yeah, taking this. So in this ribo sugar is attaches with the specific nitrogen bases are presented. These nitrogen bases we are taking means purines and pyrimidines. These are into the two types of the purine ring and the pyrimidine. Purines are there and the pyrimidines are also presented. Purines and the pyrimidines. So like that we are taking into the these purines and the pyrimidines. Totally these are the A, G, T and the C. Adenine, guanine, thymine and the cytosines. These are comes under the purine and the pyrimidines. Nitrogen bases here. Here these are the nitrogen bases of the DNA. In the case of the RNA we are taking, instead of the thymine, uracil is comes under the, instead of the thymine, uracil is forming. The remaining adenine, guanine, uracil and the cytosine is presented in the case of the RNA we are. So like this nitrogen bases and the phosphate ions are forming. Phosphate ion, diester bonds are forming here. Diphosphate, not ester, diphosphate backbone is forming by the this phosphate molecules only. Okay, so these are the components of the DNA and the RNA. These DNA in some of the animals, majority of the animal kingdom we are taking, animals of the living world we are taking, DNA act as a genetic material. DNA acting as a genetic material. And RNA, some of the primitive animals, like that is some of the viruses we are taking, some of the viruses we are taking, so there it is acting as a genetic material. But the remaining other animals we are taking, so DNA acting as a genetic material. That means the higher animals, those who are the DNA acting as a genetic material, means RNA is having or not, means RNA is also present. For example, humans, the human body we are taking, means the human genetic material is the DNA. And along with the DNA, in the cell organelles, you are taking, RNA is also presented. But it is not acting as a genetic material. So it is acting as a cell organelle. It is one of the component in the cell organelles you are taking. So like that, it is one of the nucleic acid only. But it not into the genetic information. It is not stores into the genetic information. So difference between the nucleic acid and the genetic material is, nucleic acid is a chemical component. It is a one form of the chemical component. It is forming by the these components we are taking. And the genetic material is nothing but as a, the genetic material is forming by the these nucleic acids only, but stores the genetic information. So the stored genetic information is passing from the one generation to the another generation through that genetic material only. So that one only we call as the genetic material. So this is the major difference between the nucleic acid and the, so RNA is the nucleic acid in the higher animals or the humans we are taking, but the genetic material will be the DNA molecules only, DNA, so DNA substances only acting as a genetic material here. So this is the basic difference between into the DNA and the RNA we are taking means. And through these nucleic acids and the genetic materials, the characters are transferring from the one generation to the other. So the information is transferring as a molecular level. We are molecular basis of inheritance, what it is discussing means at molecular level, how the characters, how the genes, how the information is transferring from the one generation to the another generation. So that is discussing the molecular basis of inheritance, the structure of DNA and the structure of RNA we are taking. So again here we are also discussed the DNA word and the RNA word. To explain the DNA as a genetic material, some experiments proof we are giving. Then the RNA as a genetic material, some experimental proof we are giving here. So for example, Griffith experiment, okay, Hersch and Chase experiment. These two experiments generally, there we are discussing the DNA acting as a genetic material. It transferring from the one generation to the, this transferring into the characters. So for example, the Griffith experiment, the most experiment we are taking means the pneumococcus, this streptococcus species we are taking means the pathogenic strain, S strain and the R strain. S strain we are taking, R strain we are taking. The pathogenic and the non-pathogenic strains we are taking. So non-pathogenic strain, when we are injecting, that time there is no infection, there is no symptoms or appears in the mouse. When the pathogenic strain we are introducing, injecting, that time the symptoms are appears. Suppose the pathogenic strain itself deactivating or that degenerating or denaturating by the heat, that time we are injecting, there is no pathogen, there is no activity of the pathogen into the mouse. Suppose these two strains, one is into the, suppose we are taking the pathogenic strain in the inactive condition, so non-pathogenic strain to the active condition. So these two strains are, we are together, we are injecting, that time symptoms are appears. That means one strain to other strain, the genetic materials are transforming here. So like this, the genetic material or the genetic information is transferring from one generation. So the DNA is acting as a genetic material. Like that is a, so Sir, the Chase experiment we are taking, Hersch and Chase experiment we are taking, sir, that the DNA bacteriophage and the bacterial infection. So there also the DNA acting as a genetic medium. So like these are some experimental proofs we are giving to explain the DNA and the RNA as a genetic material. Okay, this is regarding to the introduction part of the molecular basis of inheritance. Then we are taking into the how the inheritance is occurs into the molecular basis. What are the mechanisms that are involving into the in this process means? Basically, we are discussing into the three processes that are involving into the inheritance. They are the replication, transcription, and the translation process. So these are the three basic mechanisms. By these three basic mechanisms, in the individuals, the next generation formation are the physiological processes. That is the morphological process of the organism. So protein synthesis. Proteins are the building blocks of the body, and not only that, these are the units of the physiological processes we are doing. All the physiological processes of the cells is conducting by the their specific protein molecules only. So those two are the protein synthesis is involving into the transcription and the translation. So these three mechanisms are involved. These three mechanisms are explaining how the characters are transferring from the one generation to the other generation. How the new individuals are forming. The genetic information, how it is transferring. So those things are we are discussing into the in these three mechanisms we are. So one by one we can be discussed. DNA replication. Here, majority of the organism, in that the humans also can be taken. DNA act as a genetic material. This DNA, genetic material means we know that the material, the chemical substances which is stores the information, genetic information, that is called as a genetic material. So through this genetic information, it transferring into the next gen. This genetic material is transferring into the next generation. To produce this into the new generation here. Yeah. So how it is, when it is occurs, and how it is occurs means the DNA is replicating. Autonomous reproduction is okay. Autonomous reproducing. The replication is nothing but as a autonomously reproduction only. The genetic material is itself is reproducing, doubling into their number. That is the process is the replication. Generally, The cell division time at the phase S phase we are taking means, so at the S phase, that is the synthetic phase time, the DNA material is doubling. It becomes into the doubling here. That means their amount is going to increase. Two times it is increasing. So it is doubling here. So this is the process is called as a replication. When it is occur, the S phase of the cell division. Each cell, when they are going to divide, that time to produce into the next generation of the two cell. One cell is going to the dividing and forming the two cells here. So for that two cells formation, the DNA S phase, so the cell division S phase, DNA is becomes going to doubling here. So whether we are taking into the DNA replication, it is occurs both prokaryotes and as well as the eukaryotes. We are taking prokaryotic cells or the eukaryotic cell division. Both the cell division, prokaryotic cell division, it is undergoes into the replication process. Eukaryotic cell division, it is undergoes into the replication process. So we can be discuss in this mechanism by the number of steps to easily understanding the first one, origin of replication. First step is the origin of the replication. So where the replication is originate. What is mean by the origin of the replication means, in generally, the cell division time, the condensed genetic material, that is the DNA, we are taking means, it becomes modified and forming into the double stranded or the double helical DNA strands are forming. So before that, after the G1 phase or the G2 phase, where that means the genetic material becomes into the condensed state. As a mass, it is forming. But the cell division say, at the S phase time, what it is happened? Chromosomes are forming, chromatic structures are presented, and these chromosomes are forming by the a double stranded, so double helical DNA strands are forming. Here the packaging of the DNA also we know that by the histoprotein octamers formation is occurs. There we are, that means so the histoproteins, the five types of the histoproteins, they are involving into the octamer DNA packaging. So this DNA packed DNA we are taking the S phase, it forms into the double helical stretch. Here origin of the replication. What is mean by the origin of the replication means, there is a specific DNA sequence. The specific DNA sequence, that is the specific DNA sequence where it starts into the replication. Where it starts into the replication. Here we are taking means, ARCs are present. Autonomous replicating sequences are presented. Autonomous replicating sequence. A specific sequence is presented in the DNA materials we have. So this autonomous replicating sequence are ARS we are taking. How many types, how many number of the autonomous replicating sequences are present, or these are generally called as the origin of replication or of DNA or of the DNA or origin of the DNA replication. Origin of the DNA. So this origin of the DNA replication, whether you are taking into the prokaryotic cells and eukaryotic cells, you are taking means prokaryotic cells and they get. So in the case of the prokaryotic cells, they are having only the one origin of replication. So only one sequence, one specific sequence only presents here in the case of the prokaryotes. But in the case of the eukaryotes, you are taking means some multiple number of origins are presented here. Origin sites are present. Origin of replication. Here the eukaryotes multiple number it is presented. In the case of the prokaryotes, you are getting only the one it is present. Here the double stranded DNA or the double helical DNA strand. Double helical DNA strand. It is a double stranded only and double helical. Okay, helically DNA strand. So at this, either the prokaryotes or the eukaryotes, you are taking means, but one specific position or the specific sequence, that is called as a ARS sequence, where it is presented into the ARS sequence, the replication bulb is forming. Replication bulb is forming. Replication bulb is going to form here. So how it is means, for example, we are taking into the this replicate that double stranded DNA to easily explain that the double helical DNA, just we are taking as a straight line. So this is into the DNA strands. That means this is 3' 2, 5' 5' 5' 2, 3'. Suppose that. So in this DNA strand, first initially the DNA becomes into the two strands of the DNA is bonded by the hydrogen bonds. So in between the hydrogen bonds of the two strands, the double stranded DNA or double helical DNA, one specific region. Suppose in this specific region, the ARC sequence is presented or origin site is presented. So that time what it is happened means it forms a replication bulb is forming. It forms the replication bulb. So this is into the replication. So here the origin sequence is presented here. So this is called as a origin of replication. So the ARS, that is autonomous replication sequence, where it is presented, there it is forming into the replication bulb. Okay, and the two strands of the DNA is going to divided here, separated here, and forming into a bulbous structure. So in this bulbous structure, when it is going to separate, the both the strands are going to separate it. So like this, these are going to separate it. Already the both the strands are, that is the both the strands are helical in the nature. Before the separation, these are the helical in the nature. So when these are going to separate, to stand into the separately, it forming into the separately. So there is a some specific enzymes are involved. Some specific enzymes and the proteins are involving into the replication process. So later on, the next steps we can be discussing into the those structures also. So first of all, these two strand, the helically stranded are becomes undergoes into the separation by the breakdown of the hydrogen bonds between the two templates and forming the bulbous structure. This is called as a origin of replication. First step into the replication. The second step of the replication is activation of DNA. Activation of the DNA. So once the replication, origin of replication is occurred, the replication bulb is formed. Replication bulb is formed. When the replication bulb is formed, these two strands are going to unwinding here. These two strands are going to unwind. And the strands are ready for the replication process. This is called as activation of the DNA strands. The two strands between into the those two strands, the hydrogen bonds are becomes going to breaking down and they are elaborated here. So that time what it is happened means the DNA, we are taking the DNA strands, the breakdown is occurs and the strands are moving into the broadly, so separating here. So this is step is called as a activation of the DNA. So second step is the activation of the DNA, and the third step we are taking is exposure of parental DNA strands. Exposure of the parental DNA strands. Once the strands between into the hydrogen bonds are separated, the two strands are separated, to withstand into the DNA strands into the separately. Here the replication fork is forming. Fork is nothing but as a, there is a specific enzymes are involving In the replication bulb, generally it is called as a helicase. The helicase, the proteins, the helicase enzymes are, these are continuous the end of the DNA template here. From where means, from where the origin of the site it is started and it continues towards into the end of the DNA template here. So that time what these are doing means unzipping they are doing. That means the two strands are going and forming into the Y-shaped structure. This is the Y-shaped structure is forming here. And the helicase is moving towards into the another end of the DNA strand. Actually this is the, this force is called as a replication fork. This force is called as a replication fork is forming. So once the helicase is unwinding into the DNA strands, that time the DNA strands are exposing to the replication process here. Actually these are into the two parental strands here. Whether we are taking into the replication process, conservative, semi-conservative, disruptive mode of replications are explained. Conservative mode of replication and the dispersive mode of replication, practically these are not satisfied with the entire mechanism of the replication. Okay, all the so applications of the DNA material or the gene. So these two are failed. The semi-conservative mode of the replication only most acceptable model, that is explained with the Watson and the Crick. Now whatever the replication mechanism we are discussing, replication process, DNA structure we are discussing, that is a Watson Crick model only. And the Taylor is explains that the semi-conservative mode of the replication process we are taking. In the first one, conservative mode of replication, what it is explaining is, for example, we are taking to the parental double helical DNA strand is forming into the a new double helical DNA strand is formed. That means after the replication, so one complete DNA is a double helical DNA is the parental one only. The new one is forming into one complete DNA. That means after the replication process, the two cells of the individuals, so whatever the two new cells are forming, one cell it is itself is having the only the parental so DNA templates, and the other cell is having the only the new DNA templates or the new DNA strands are present. So in this type of the conservation is in this type of the replication is called as a conservative replication. Actually it is not explained the how the inheritance process is occurs and how the newly formed so organisms they are having into the their parental mixed characters or recombinant characters, how they are having. So that points they are not explained by the in this model. And the disruptive model we are taking means the parental strand is forming after the replication, the new strand is forming. That new strand we are taking means forming by the number of mixed, so both the parental and the newly formed so DNA fragments are mixedly, so they are forming into the DNA so structure we are taking. So this is the called as disruptive form of the replication here. It is also not explained. The semi-conservative model we are taking means the parental strand of the, so one parental strand with the newly formed their complementary DNA is forming into the one cell, and another parental strand with the newly formed DNA forming into the another cell. That means each cell after the replication, after the cell division we are taking, sir, each cell is having one parental strand and one newly formed, so DNA strands are forming their genetic material. So like that, the another cell also one parental strand and another newly formed, so DNA template is presented into the their genetic. So this type of, it is not completely the conservative, it is a semi. So one strand into the parent, one strand into the new strand. So that only it is called as a semi-conservative mode of replication. Now we following into the semi-conservative mode of replication. Here in this semi-conservative mode of replication, what it is, the exposure of the parental DNA strand means whenever the replication bulb is occurs, so the replication fork is forming. This replication fork is moving towards into the end of the DNA strand. Suppose into the prokaryotes you are, that means the DNA becomes into the circular DNA is presented. Here the replication fork is, the replication bulb is forming here and it may move into the both the direction. So it is called as a bidirectional replication fork. But in the case of the eukaryotes, we are determining, sir, the DNA is linearly it is presented. The replication fork is passing into the a single direction. It is called as a unidirectional replication here. It is a bidirectional. So two forms, two directions. Sometimes it is into the two directions into the some of the genetic material, some of the genetic material single direction. Here, whenever it is the replication fork is moving towards into the another end, that time the helicase is useful unwinding of the helix, double helix. So DNA strands are going to separate here and forming into the replication fork. So at that time, the both the templates of the DNA is exposed to the replication and each template is acting as a coding and the So each one is acting as a DNA template. In this DNA strand or in this DNA strand, it is acting as a DNA templates here. So this is into the third step of the replication we are taking. And the fourth step we are taking means, before going to the fourth step, whenever the unwinding is occurs because of the helicase, the enzyme helicase, to stand into the this single strand DNA templates, there is a specific proteins are attaches to the DNA templates. These are called as SSB proteins, single strand binding proteins, SSBP, single strand bindings. With the help of the single strand binding proteins, the unwinded DNA templates are retained same as a single strands. These are not again going into the helical in the nature. Why? So these are binded by the single strand proteins, sir, and these are acting as the pins. These are the holding pins like that. So this template is going unwinding like this, and this template is unwinding like this, and these are fixed strand by the use of the this single strand binding proteins here. And when the replication fork is moving towards the ends, the helicase is moving towards into the in this direction, replication fork direction, the super coiling is possible. The force, there is a helical force is occurs into the DNA templates and the DNA strand, that is called as a supercoiling. The supercoiling force is occurs. To reduce into the supercoiling, so there is a two types of the enzymes. In the case of the eukaryotes, you are taking means topoisomerase. It is reducing into the supercoiling in the replication. Okay, it reduces into the supercoiling forces in the replication of the DNA. In the case of the prokaryotes, we are taking gyrase is involving into the supercoiling effect, to reducing into the supercoiling effect into the replicating DNA template. So this step is comes under the third one, that is the exposure of the parental DNA. Once the parental DNA is exposed, next one is the formation of RNA primer. Fourth step will be the formation of the RNA primer. So how, what is the RNA primer and how it is forming means? First step, the DNA is unwinded and forming into the replication bar, and two strands are forming. Here we are taking means 5 prime to 3 prime and the 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Here in these two strands, one strand is acting as a continuously, it is synthesized here. One strand is discontinuously, it is synthesized. Actually, in this process, the nitrogen base, the active form of the nitrogen bases, the nitrogen base pool is presented in the nucleoplasm. We are there. That means DATP, DGTP, DCTP, and TTP. These are the four types of nitrogen bases here. ATP, GTP, CTP, and the TTP is forming. So how these are forming means, by the phosphorylation process only we are taking this. By the phosphorylation process only. So how the phosphorylation is occurs means, initially the AMP, GMP, CMP or the TMP, monophosphates, okay, pyrophosphatase, phosphorylation process, these are undergoes into the triphosphate, their corresponding ATP forms here, or the DGTP forms, DCTP or DTTP. So triphosphates are formed. The monophosphate units are by the taking of phosphate ion, phosphorylation is occurs and converting into the triphosphate ions. Actually, in this mechanism, whatever it is, the triphosphates are formed, these are again converted as a monophosphates here, and that time whatever it is, the energy it is releases, that is used for the replication process here. So how the replication process is getting into the energy means, whatever it is the phosphorylated, so these nitrogen bases is going to the monophosphate forms, monomer units are forming, that time energy is released, that energy is utilized into the replication. So in this fourth step we are taking means formation of the RNA primer. Here the replication force or the replication process always occurs into the 5 prime to 3 prime direction only. That means the nucleic acids are attaching, the new strand is forming from the 5 prime to 3 prime direction only. So how it is means, Here the DNA templates. This is the DNA template, and this is also another DNA template. 3 prime to 5 prime direction, and the 5 prime to 3 prime. So in this 3 prime to 5 prime direction, in this DNA template, we are taking sir one specific RNA strand sequence is coming and attaching here. One specific RNA strand. Actually, we are taking this RNA strand is having the 4 to 20 RNA molecules. Okay, 4 to 20 RNA molecules. RNA, so nitrogen bases are forming. So this 4 to 20, so nitrogen base RNA strand is called as a primer. It is called as a RNA primer here. RNA prime. So once the RNA primer is coming and attaching into the 3 prime end of the one template. Okay. So in this template RNA. Here how it is attaching the RNA? RNA is the 5 prime. The 3 prime end of the RNA is having into the OH group here. Okay. The hydroxy group is presented. A free hydroxy group is presented. Actually, to polymerize into the DNA, it needs into the 3 prime OH hydroxy group is required here. So that will directly the DNA, so nitrogen bases coming and not attaching with the, so in this template here, the complementary it is not produces. So it they requires into the free hydroxy group. This free hydroxy group is providing by the RNA primer. Once the RNA primer is coming and they are attaching into the replication origin site. Where it is coming? It is comes into the replication origin site here, or replication origin site. So here their corresponding sequence, the sequence whatever it may be presented into the in this strand of the DNA, their complementary nitrogen bases are coming and attaching with the in this strand. So continuously the DNA strand, the DNA strand is the nitrogen bases are attaching and forming into the a new DNA template is forming. So actually in this strand is called as a leading strand. Leading strand here. The another strand we are taking means replication bulb. Here the replication bulb it is moving in this strand, that time the 5 prime or the 3 prime of the DNA template is available continuously. But here the 3 prime of the DNA template is not available. It is already closed here. So here after the certain distance of the replication fork is moving. So in middle of so many RNA primers are forming. So here it is a one RNA primer. And here it is the one another RNA primer here, and there like this a number of RNA primers are forming here, and these number of RNA primers are the complementary DNA nitrogen base, the complementary DNA strands are forming. This strand is called as a lagging strand here. Lagging strand is called as a lagging. So this is the leading strand and this is into the lagging. So like this, initially the RNA primer and coming and attaching into the origin site of the DNA we are. So this is nothing but as a formation of the RNA primer here. Next one, what it is happened, the all the DNA nitrogen bases, all the nitrogen bases. Here these nitrogen bases from where to we are getting means phosphorylation, the phosphorylated the monomer of the these nitrogen bases are converted into the primers. DATP, DGTP, GCTP is forming into the nuclear pool here. Nuclear pool only it is occurs, or the nitrogen base pool is occurs into the nucleoplasm. So in this, from this nucleoplasm to this nitrogen base pool, they are taking into the ATP, GTP, CTP or the TTP according to the template sequence here. So that time their corresponding ATP, GTP or the CTP or the TTP, thymine, cytosine, guanine or the adenine are taking, based on their complementary. For example, here the adenine is presented into the template stand. Their opposite, the thymine, the GT, the TTP is coming and it becomes separated as a monomeric form. How it is means? The enzyme is called as a pyrophosphate. The ATP, the ATP is converted pyrophosphate. The presence of pyrophosphate is converting the monomeric form AMP is forming plus PI molecule energy is forming. So this energy is utilizing for the replication for process here. So now whatever it is, the AMP molecule monomeric forms are presented, the corresponding AMP, GMP, TMP or the CMP, based on into the sequence of the template, they are continuously arranged into the DNA template here. So later on, what it is happening means in between them, the DNA strand, the newly synthesized DNA strand is forming. Newly, so in between these nucleotide nitrogen bases, the attachment is occurs, and these are forming into the bonding between into the. So in this parental strand and the new strand, the hydrogen bonds are forming. This is into the another next step of the DNA replication. What is that? Pairing of nitrogen bases. Pairing of nitrogen bases. Here the nitrogen bases, whatever it is present, forming into the new strand. Those are paired with the already existing parental strand here. So this is into the, this is called as a pairing or the base pairing. The pairing of the nitrogen bases here or base pairing is occurs. Once the base pairing is occurs, the next step into the DNA. Here the leading strand we are taking, so new strand is forming, new DNA template is forming and the already template is presented. And here the number of fragments of RNA primers are presented. Later on these primers are removed and in between the gap of these primers are filling by the DNA template. Actually these fragments are called as a Okazaki fragments. The RNA fragments, the RNA primer with the DNA fragments, whatever they are producing on lagging strand, these are called as a Okazaki fragments. The scientist Okazaki is identified into the these fragments, so that only called as a Okazaki fragment. So the Okazaki fragments are also forming as a one DNA template, and the already leading strand is also forming into the continuously forming along with the replication force. It is synthesizing into the new DNA strand is forming. DNA, so template is formed. So these two are in between the nitrogen bases of the new strand and the old DNA template. New template and the old DNA template. Base pairing already occurs here. Base pairing already occurs. That means the hydrogen bonds are forming here. The hydrogen bonds are formed. Once the hydrogen bonding is formed, we know that the propoisomerase or the gyrase, they are removed from their places. They are removed from their places here. So once they are removed from their places, and the single strand binding proteins also, they are replacing here. They are replacing and forming into the new strand here. The base pairing is occurs and forming into the new strand. New strand is forming. like this new template and the old template together, a new strand is forming. Double-stranded DNA is formed. So this time there is no helical nature. So in this strand is forming into the in these two templates are forming into the one strand, and these two templates are forming into the another strand. We are two strand from the one DNA. So DNA molecule to two DNA molecules are forming here. So this type, in this one is into the older parental one, another one is into the new one. Here also one is into the parental one and other one is into the new. So it is called as a semi-conservative mode of the replication we are taking. So after this formation of the new strands, we are taking means sometimes there is a possibility of the mismatching here. Actually, this formation of the new strand formation we are taking, sir, DNA, the polymerization of the DNA is occurs by the three types of the enzymes, pole 1, pole 2 and the pole 3 here. That is the DNA polymerase 1, DNA polymerase 2 and the DNA polymerase 3 here. And not only that, DNA ligase, you are taking DNA ligase is also presented here. So in this, the DNA polymerase 3 we are taking, sir, it is a major enzyme into the DNA replication process. So by the DNA polymerase 3, it is arranging into the nitrogen bases complementary to that of the DNA templates. So according to the complementary nitrogen base sequence of the DNA template, the nitrogen bases from the nitrogen base pool, so they are taking and arranging into the continuous. Once it is arranging into the continuously, the DNA ligase is going to bind with the all the DNA nitrogen bases of the newly arranged into the DNA nitrogen bases into the new and forming into the new strand here. So like this, the new strand is forming into the template strand. The same way here also, the new strand is forming into the, that is the lagging strand also. These two strands are formed, but there is sometimes, there is a possibility instead of the, here the adenine is presented into the template, instead of the forming into the complementary thymine, by mismatchly, these are places into the guanine or the cytosine or the some other any nitrogen base. That means the mismatch is occurs. Mismatch is possible in the case of the replication. How much the frequency of the replication means 1 out of the 10,000 nitrogen bases sequences we are taking. Out of the 10,000 nitrogen base sequences, 1 mismatch is possible. So this mismatched nitrogen base sequence, again the RNA polymerase after the formation of the new strand going further, so again going back to the further reading of the new strand, along with this, the polymerase 1 and the polymerase 2 is involving into the repair of the mismatches here. So the pole 1 we are taking, means wherever it is a mismatch is there, the mismatch is presented, the nitrogen base is replaced, removed from this and forming their corresponding nitrogen base is inserted and sealing into the DNA new strand here. So this is the process called as a proofreading. The last step into the replication called as a proofreading process. The DNA polymerase 1 and the DNA polymerase 2 is involving into the repair process, and the DNA polymerase 3, when it is going to the proofreading, it is not, proofreading is also conducting by the DNA polymerase 3, but there is a one small exemption is there here. The DNA polymerase 3 we are taking, sir, here the thymine is, instead of the thymine, guanine is formed. So this guanine is replacing by the DNA polymerase 1, pole 1 here, and in that place is replacing with the corresponding thymine by the pole 1. So this is called as a proofread. Once the proofreading is completed, in these two strands are going to helically, again the helicase is removed from that and the single strand binding proteins are also removed from this template, and these two strands are going to helical and these two strands are going to helical here, and it is forming into the one DNA and it is forming into the other DNA strand here. So like these two DNA molecules are forming from the one DNA molecule to two DNA, that is their number, their amount is becomes to doubling here. These are the steps are involving into the DNA replication. Simply, so these are steps. What are the origin of the replication? Replication bulb is forming. Next, activation of the DNA. So the replication bulb is moving towards into the one direction here. It is moving towards into the one direction. When it is moving into the one direction, replication fork is forming and unzipping is occurs. A Y-shaped replication fork and the templates are forming. At the same time, the monophosphates of monomers of DNA M bases, nitrogen bases we are taking insert. These are undergoes into the phosphorylation and forming into the triphosphate molecule. So the triphosphate molecules are forming here. So activation is occurs. So this is into the activation. Next, exposure. The template is going to expose to the replication proof, for the reading process here. Next one, formation of the RNA primer. In these templates, RNA primers are forming. Next, base pairs are, their complementary base pairs are coming and standing into the opposite. This is the base pairing. And after the pairing, the nitrogen bases are combining and forming into the new strands are forming. Once the new strand is forming, sometimes the mismatching is occurs, that mismatches are replacing by the next step is called as a proofreading. This is the total overall into the DNA replication process here.